We are so glad that you joined us today. God wants to do so much for you and through you, and we want to hear about it. So please take a moment to share your story with us at mystory@lbtlima.org. If you would also like to contribute financially to the ministry, you can do so at limabaptisttemple.org or download our church app available for iPhone and Android users. Thank you again for joining us. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Here I am, I've come to find you.
Christ alone.
You always fill my heart.
Our country is fearful of a lot of things. Some of the countries, as you know today, the U.S. and all the protests is going on about immigration, on about we're not allowing 7 Muslim countries to enter the states. We're not, and then Iran defies the U.N., and now they're defying the U.S. and what President Trump's warning that he had given them, and firing ballistic missiles against everything. I mean, whether it's the economy or whatever, people have fear. But today, I want to talk to you today about more of the unrealistic fears too. You know, which is called a phobia. 1 out of every 10 people have a phobia. And basically, that is an unrealistic fear. So, for example, the phobias, they go from A to Z. One is acrophobia, the fear of heights. Some of you probably have that. Some of you have probably haven't gotten over it. And what we're going to do to practice, if you'll go walk that top ledge right there while I'm preaching. I had the fear of, I didn't even look it up, but of, you know, drowning and swimming. And my brothers just threw me off a big tall bridge. And after I nearly drowned 3 times, I learned to swim. True story there. Zoophobia, the fear of animals. Agoraphobia, the fear of wide open places. And then claustrophobia, which is the opposite, the fear of enclosed places. But the one I think a lot of Baptists have, neophobia, the people who are afraid of new things. Amen? But thank God we're not like that, okay, church? We want to try anything we can as long as it reaches people for Jesus. It doesn't matter whether we did it before or not. You know, people have these phobias today, and God says that He has not given us the spirit of fear, and He does not want you to be in bondage to fear. Yet everywhere I find believers who are limited by fear. Believers all over. I mean, believers who are intimidated by the fears that they face every day when they go to work, even as they rear their children. You know, I remember, and I may have said something like this before, but, you know, in raising children, some of you have the real young babies. So I just say from, you know, birth up to whatever age, 2 or 3, and, you know, you have to leave them with someone else. Maybe your grandparents, you know, maybe your parents. And you leave a list about this long. Now, you can't get the water, but this temperature, you've got to feed them this way, right? Like they've never raised kids before. We do that. We have all these crazy fears. We do all these crazy things. The devil has a way of giving us that spirit unto fear. As a pastor, I've watched people deal with fear. Tragic news, cancer, divorce, elderly parents, wayward children. And I mean, on and on it goes. And that's not a stranger to most of us here, if we're honest. Not all fear is bad. Some fear is good. The Bible says, this is what our theme verse is where Lori and I graduated from the University of Mobile in Alabama. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Amen to that verse. Now, let me give you my version. If you don't have a fear of God, then you don't have one bit of sense. Okay? Wisdom begins with the right respect of God and who God is. Not all fear is bad. I mean, I wouldn't tell my children that a rattlesnake, just to pick it up, you know, or do not, you know, watch as you cross the street, okay? You need to be afraid of some things. You need to have a healthy kind of fear. So it is not saying don't be afraid. There's a good kind of fear. There's a healthy kind of fear. But I'm talking today about the kind of fear that limits you, that binds you, that hems you in, that debilitates you, that makes your life very unproductive for the Lord. And I want to tell you, like I said last week, fear can paralyze you. It can immobilize you just like discouragement can. Fear can keep us from becoming what God desires for us. God desires for us to have a faith that can move mountains. So I want to talk to you today about facing your fear, whatever that may be. And there's a lot of these fears represented in here today, just a lot of fear. In the New Testament, Jesus said a lot to his disciples about don't be afraid. And then we go over to the Old Testament, where we'll be talking about today, in Numbers 13 and 14. But there's a better rendering in Deuteronomy 1 than what we're going to look at today. But if you remember in Deuteronomy 13, 1, the Lord, God, told Moses to send out some spies to spy out the land of Canaan, the land that he had already given them. And you remember the people of Israel, they had been delivered out of Egypt and on verge of the promised land, the land of Canaan. In the border town there of Kadesh Barnea, he sent them out to look it over. Moses sent 12 men to spy out the land. Now, all of you don't know the story. I can't tell it all because I don't assume everybody even knows the story today. Okay? But sent out 12 spies, and 10 returned with a horrible negative report. They saw the people as what? Giants. They saw themselves as grasshoppers. They talked about their cities and everything was built all the way up to heaven. That's pretty tall. Amen? But there were two guys, Joshua and Caleb. And I love both, but I love Caleb because Caleb was a man of a different spirit. Joshua was too, but the Bible always makes it plain about Caleb. In fact, when Caleb was 85 years old, he said, "Here I am, give me my mountain." It's amazing what happened in this story, because what happened here is this changed Israel's history for the next 40 years. And I want us to see how fear grows and feeds on itself. So the first thing I want to talk about is feeding the fear. Some principles regarding fear. First of all, listen to this. Fear disregards. It disregards God's plans. Do you think God's plan is for you to fear everything else but Him? No. God is not into us being afraid. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verses 19 through 21. Then we set out of Horeb and went through all that great and terrifying wilderness that you saw on the way to the hill country of the Amorites, as the Lord of God commanded us. And we came to Kadesh Barnea, and I said to you, "You have come to the hill country of the Amorites, which the Lord our God," listen to this, "is giving us. See, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up, take the possession, as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has told you." Now look at this. "Do not fear or be dismayed." You see, it was God's promise. It was theirs. All they had to do was what God had promised them, and that is to go in and take it. They didn't even have to ask for it. But they didn't do it because of fear. Fear kept them from receiving God's inheritance. In other words, His plan. We too have a similar inheritance. In 2 Timothy 1:7, "For God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and of love and self-control." In Romans 8:15, "For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons." You see, when we back away, and when we even sense God is in it all of us still must cross the boundary of fear in order to go to the next level and reach there beyond what God wants for us. So understand, first of all, fear disregards. It disregards God's plans. But second, fear distorts. It distorts God's purposes, your perception of God, how you see Him. How did the other 10 see Him? Small. They saw the people there as giants. Basically, they saw Jesus as a grasshopper, as themselves, but not Joshua and Caleb. Let me ask you something. How do you view God today? no matter what's going on in your life. He never changes. Look at verses 22 through 28. Then all of you came near me and said, let us send men before us, that they may explore the land for us and bring us word again of the way by which we must go up and the cities into which we shall come. The thing seemed good to me, and I took 12 men from you, one man from each tribe. And they turned and went up into the hill country and came to the valley of Eshel and spied out. And they took in their hands some of the fruit of the land and brought it down to us and brought us word again and said, it is a good land that the Lord our God has given us. Listen how many times he's gave it to us. He's given it to us. Go. Yet you would not go up, but rebelled against the command of the Lord your God. And you murmured in your tents. See, murmuring started way back there. And said, because the Lord hated us, he has brought us out of the land of Egypt to give us into the hand of Amorites to destroy us. Do you realize all the miracles they'd already seen? Where are we going up? Our brothers have made our hearts melt, saying, the people are greater and taller than we. The cities are great and fortified up to heaven. That's tall. And besides, we have seen the sons of Anakim there. Big men. Well, 10 came back, and because of fear, they distorted the picture. Yes, there were giants, but not all were giants. Yes, cities, tall walls, but not all the way up to heaven. And God didn't send them there because he hated them. Fear and God becomes enemies. Listen, they were standing on the edge of the greatest days of their life, but fear warped their whole thinking process. Fear was distorting their picture. It distorted their picture to all of their countrymen. Fear will distort everything you see and keep you from God's blessings. Let me ask you something. What has God told you to do in the last week, the last day or whatever, and you still have not done it because of fear? And you know God's the one telling you to do that. It distorts God's purpose for us. We must not live in fear. It's not God's plan. We need to understand that. But third, fear discourages. Fear discourages. It discourages God's people, just like right here. It only took 10 to come back and say, this can't be done. I mean, I want to say this. I'm not into the politics thing today. But whether you voted for Trump, whether you voted for Hillary, whether you voted for somebody else, you didn't vote for anybody, we need to realize that President Donald Trump is the president of the United States of America. We need to understand that. And there should be a respect there for the authority. It's just that negativity. Listen, verse 28. Where are we going up? Our brothers have made our hearts melt, saying the people are greater and taller than we. The cities are great and fortified up to heaven. And besides, we have the sons of Anakim there. Well, do some math. About 2 million people. Moses sends 12. 10 comes back and talks about, oh my gosh. The negative report of 10 people terrified the whole nation of 2 million. The fear deterred the nation. Fear is epidemic. And it spreads quickly. You see that today if you turn on the news. The power of fear. 10 people kept the whole nation from experiencing what God wanted. The same thing can happen in a church. It only takes a few to be negative, to be fearful. But the few sound like 1,000 depending on what they're saying. But understand, the Lord only needs a few good men. We'll see that in a minute in Gideon, okay? Listen, the power of fear. Fear is a powerful force. But next, fear doesn't only discourage, it disbelieves. Now look at verses 29 through 33. Then I said to you, do not be in dread or afraid of them. The Lord your God, who goes before you, will himself fight for you, just as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. Listen, the Lord was even going to fight for them. And in the wilderness, where you have seen how the Lord your God carried you, as a man carries his son all the way that you went until you came to this place, yet in spite of his word, you did not believe the Lord your God, who went before you in the way to seek you out of a place to pitch your tents in fire by night and in the cloud by day to show you by what you should go. Do you understand, Lima Baptist Temple, that this community and this city is ours for the taking? That's what the Lord's saying. That's what he told them. Hey, it's for you. It's for the taking. But you're afraid. Just remember how God has always been there for you, providing. Remember, God carried you. You can take the land. If not careful, you will be victimized. But fear does another big, big thing. It disobeys. It disobeys. I asked that earlier. Is there anything that God has told you to do and you've not done it? You're living in sin. Fear disobeys. Listen, it disobeys God's principles. Look at verse 26. I'll just say it. You saw it. But they rebelled. That's what they were rebelling. They were just in a bunch of rebellion there. Ever think of your fear as rebellion? Exactly what God says. If God has spoken, we must not listen to the enemy. It's rebellion. So most of you should have received your letter that I wrote in the finance committee about the Mountain Moving Faith campaign. And it explained what we're looking to do. And we had 89% of that vote that passed. And it was just phenomenal what God still wants to do here. But you understand, as part of God's principles, is the giving the tithe. And I'm speaking to 70 or 80% of you that probably do not really tithe, totally tithe. That's okay. I want you to hear my heart today. You live in disobedience when you don't obey God's principles. And you need to understand, until you understand, that you don't have to be fearful, that you can live off of that 90% better than you can that 100% or that 80% or that 70%. You'll never understand it until you try. The only verse in the Bible, again, as I shared before, where God says, test me, try me, and prove me. Some of you want to know, do I give off the net? Do I give off the gross? God's got a big shovel, I'll tell you that. And I could have, there's a lot of people in here I could have come stand and give a testimony about how God has blessed them. Many of you are my friends. You're in business. You still try to figure out, well, what do I put in my business or what do I do here? You know, you may have $5 million in the bank. You may pay yourself $25,000 a year, so you only give $2,500. I don't think that's what God's saying. You understand what I'm saying? It is God's, and you need to obey him in all things. There's no issues here in getting what God's called us to do, the money, because the money is here. Fear destroys. Verses 34 through 40. And the Lord heard your words and was angered. And he swore, not one of these men of this evil generation shall see the good land that I swore to give your fathers, except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh. He shall see it, and to him, to his children, I will give the land on which he has trodden, because he has, wait a minute, followed God. What's that word? Wholly followed God. Listen, if you are disobedient to God in any area in your life, then you are totally disobedient. That's what you need to understand. Even with me, the Lord was angry on your account and said, you also shall not go in there. Joshua, the son of Nun, who stands before you, he shall enter. Encourage him, for he shall cause Israel to inherit it. And as for your little ones, who you said would become a prey, and your children, who today, listen, the children, they had no knowledge of good or evil. They shall go in there. And to them I will give it, and they shall possess it. But as for you, turn and journey into the wilderness in the direction of the Red Sea. Wow. Because they were afraid and refused and disobeyed, here comes the destruction. God said, okay, none but Joshua and Caleb will enter. And the main reason you wouldn't go in is because you didn't trust me to protect your children. But guess what? They're going in anyway. They had no knowledge of good or evil. That's what's so sad in this protest, when you see children protesting because their mom and daddy's telling them what it's crazy. No knowledge. And for the next 40 years, Israel wandered and waited. All they did was go to funerals. A whole generation died off because they refused to express their faith. Some of you here are wondering because you came to a crossroad. And when at that crossroad, you turned the wrong way. You didn't lose your salvation, but you lost your joy. You forgot what it's like to be in the presence of God Almighty like you used to be. You remember the story of the talents, don't you? You remember the story about Jesus, and you know, he talked about the wealthy man, and he came and he called three of his servants and he said, hey, I'm getting ready to go, but when I come back, there will be a counting of what I give you. So I'm giving you five talents. The other he gave three. The other he gave one. So he comes back from his journey. He calls them in, see what's going on. One man had, you know, the talents at five, and he said, here, master, I have five more. And he gave them to him. The other said, hey, I got three more. And then he came to the one that had the one and said, well, I was scared, and I went and hid it, you know, buried it in the ground. Remember that? There's a lot of stuff Jesus told him. But I want to tell you, a lot of God's people are doing that today. You know why? Because the devil has you hemmed in by fear. How can you serve God if you are constantly afraid of the problems of life, of all the uncertainties of life, of things that might happen? You see, fear brings failure in the Christian life. You see, 90% of the things that we worry about never comes true. Some of you have been thinking, what if they pushed that button and sent that nuclear weapon and it hit right here? Well, we wouldn't have to worry about it because we're gone. That's why it's good to be a Christian. You may want to think about that when I give the invitation today. But you think about how much stuff you've worried about. Some of you have gotten horrible reports from the doctors. And let's call it what it is. If it's God's timing for you to die, you will die. That's why salvation, today is the day of salvation. And when you're saved, heads you win, tails you win. Get it? But for some of you, you're fearing that there's no cure. You're fearing that there's no cure to your marriage. There's no cure. Understand, if you're still breathing, there's still hope as long as you realize who holds all hope. God Almighty. We need to understand that today, people. Listen, how can you serve God if you're constantly afraid of those things? Timothy, even Timothy was ashamed to testify of the Lord. He didn't have that boldness. He didn't have that fire. He didn't have that power of God or the motivation in his life. If you want to know the truth, like some of us, his get up and go had already got up and gone. You know what I mean? No longer was he excited for God. And here we church, when the devil brings that kind of fear in your life, you bury your talent in the ground, you forget about the gift of God that is in you, and you are ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. And that is exactly where the devil wants you to be. Maybe some of you say, Al, that's me. That's me right there. What do I do? Well, I'm going to tell you what you do. You face your fear and you quit feeding it. Okay? And here it is. Facing the fear. Last point. Paul said in 2 Timothy, again, 1:7, and the ESV, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. In the KJV, it uses another word, For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. In other words, God has given us a threefold blessing to help overcome the spirit of fear in our life. First, God has equipped us with power. He has equipped us with power. God didn't give us the spirit of fear. There is a spirit of fear and a spirit of bondage, the Bible says, that is just no good. In other words, there's a spirit that will bind you, that will cripple you, that will paralyze you, that will limit you, that will debilitate you, and it will hem you in. And some of you are hemmed in today because of that fear, whatever it may be. You know, when a church becomes afraid, when God's people allow a spirit of fear to grip their heart, it brings disaster. That's why, if you remember, in Judges chapter 7, another, just one of my favorite stories, the Lord told Gideon to go take the other country, and the Amalekites and all of that, and the Jebusites and the Tikbites. You've heard me say that, okay? He said, go take them. And he said, get me some men. And he said, I got 32,000 men. He said, hey, I don't want them saying you had a lot of people. You know, I want them to know this was of God. So I want you to go back and just tell some, hey, if you know, this could be tough. If you thinking you may have a little fear, leave. 22,000 skedaddled that quick. Okay? But then there was 10,000. Well, Lord, I got, no, that's too many. Take them down and, you know, one drinks this way, the other stands up. You know the story? He separated them. Only 300 people went to battle. And you know the rest of the story. They annihilated them. Now listen to me. God would rather have 300 people who are bold for him and believe him than to have 32,000 people who are afraid of the enemy. It's the same thing in a church. You need to understand that. You see, fear brings defeat. God has given the spirit of power, and the spirit of power is the Holy Spirit. So Paul, he needs to encourage Timothy, and he writes to Timothy, and he says, don't forget that spirit who dwells in you is the Holy Spirit of God. He is the spirit of power. It is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Do you believe that this morning? The same power that raised Jesus from the dead, and we're walking around fearing everything. Please. Understand, this is the word of God. The same spirit dwells in your life. Don't forget the spirit of power. Don't you thank God, man, for the Holy Spirit he has given you? I thank God for the Holy Spirit. He dwells in my life. He is my sustainer. He is my guide. He is my provider. He is my counselor. It just goes on and on. And I am so thankful today that I have one inside of me who is stronger than the enemy. The Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Do you know what makes us afraid? When we think our enemy is greater than we are. That is really where fear comes from. You know, bullying is a big thing today, and maybe some of you grew up and you were bullied. You know, just people harassing you. There is one who lives in you who is stronger than the bully who is harassing you. The Bible says that Satan is the accuser of the brethren. And it is his job to go around, and he does a good job of this, harassing the saints of God, intimidating the saints of God, trying to make us feel small, insignificant, weak, and insufficient. But there is one in you that is stronger, the Holy Spirit of God. And he is greater than the one who is in the world. And you can rely on him. You can confess your sins to him. And you, listen, And let Him fill your life moment by moment and day by day. You are going to find that God has given you the Spirit of power, the mightiest power in the world, the power that raised Jesus Christ, His only Son, from the dead. Wow. Not only did He equip us with power to help you overcome fear, He also enriched us with love. Verse 7 says, a spirit of love. You know, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of the love of God. There's no greater force in your life than the love of God shed in your heart by the Spirit that God has given unto you. You know, in John 4:18, the Bible says in the King James, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. If you've ever been afraid of going on a job interview, if you've ever been afraid of what somebody was going to say, if you've ever been afraid or facing a certain situation, you've ever been afraid of an uncertain future, then you know how fear has torment. But that word torment actually means to limit or to restrict or to bind, or as the ESV says, punish. Punishment. Fear will bind you. Fear will bind a church. Fear will keep a church from ever being what God intended them to be. We need to understand that today. Listen, this means, the Bible says, perfect love casts out all fear. This means you do not have to fear the one who you know loves you perfectly. You don't have to fear it. You don't have to do it. And that is talking about God's love for you. That is not talking about your love for God. Big difference. That is talking about God's love for you. When you realize how much God cares, when you realize how much God loves you, that destroys the power of fear in your life. Because you're not afraid. When you know you have someone strong as God, as powerful as God, who loves you so much. Can anybody testify to that? Amen? In the Bible, the opposite of the fear is love. The knowledge of His great love will cast out all fear. Did you ever have a security blanket? Some of you got kids like that, or maybe you were. You know, like Linus and them back in Charlie Brown, carrying that thing everywhere you went. I mean, man, and then if you're a parent, you may have washed that thing 1,000 times and that sucker's so torn and it's just barely together and it's just getting smaller and smaller. But you know, some of you that had that security blanket, many of us can identify with that, or maybe your kids, you know, we would just take that blanket everywhere we'd go. We would hug it. Man, we would rub it up against it. It just made us feel secure, the warmth of it. Just clutching it tightly. Well, you have a security blanket as a child of God. There's a child in us that never grows up as long as we live, whether we are 9 or 90, but there is a child in our makeup. And if you have, listen, Jesus, you have a security blanket, which is the love of God. You see, God just takes His love and wraps it around you as a believer, and He enfolds you in His love. God didn't give us the spirit of fear. You are equipped with power and you are enriched in love. And lastly, He gave us the spirit of understanding. He enlightened us with understanding. Paul goes on to say, He gave us the spirit of a sound mind, self-control. Have you ever had a nightmare? Huh? Yeah, you thought you saw a monster in your room? I mean, I have nightmares a lot, you know. But I want you to know that some of those things, of those phobias, appears real, doesn't it? Seems like it is, but it's really not. But you know, if you ever just done that, and you know, it's like the story would be told. Some kid, you know, called his mom in the room, and you know, because he was just having nightmares, said, "I see a monster in the room." And basically, it would just be maybe some clothes over a chair or something like that. I mean, if you've got kids, we've all done that. You know, and you just think that, you know, you see something, but it's really not. And I want you to understand, it looked real, but when the light was turned on, you saw it wasn't real. Now, folks, listen to me. I want to tell you, that is exactly how Satan works. Fear, false evidence appearing real. You agree with that? The devil makes what he wants you to believe look so real, look so scary and threatening that fear grips your life. And the emotions that you experience, the fear that you experience is very real. But when you read the Word of God and the promises of God, He turns the light on. And God says, no, this is the way it really is. Greater is me who's in you than the evil one that is in the world. This is the way it really is. Look, you have the victory through Jesus Christ. It's time to live like that. You see, what the devil was doing, he was going around, it looked real in the darkness, but when you read the light of God's word, God always turns the light on, and you know that it's not real what the devil brings in your life. Friend, that is what God's word is all about. Reality is not how you feel about something. Reality is not how you perceive something. Reality about the future is not how you sense something with your mind. Reality is what God Almighty says. That's reality. This is reality. This is the truth of God, and this is the way it is. This Bible says that we are what? More than conquerors. More than conquerors. Through Him that loved us. The Bible says that if we will keep what we have committed in our life to Jesus Christ, He is able to keep that which is committed until Him against that day. You remember that song? And the greatest weapon ever formed against fear is to have Christ on the throne of your heart and life. Some of you in here fearful, and you should be fearful of what your life will be without Jesus. But you don't have to leave that way today. You can get to know this almighty, loving, perfect God. You don't have to fear man. You don't have to fear the devil. You don't have to fear the future. And you don't have to fear the uncertain present. He is the God of angel armies. He is an awesome God. So let me close here. Paul said, here is the crux of it all. In 2 Timothy 1:2, he said, I know whom I have believed. Do you? He didn't say, I know in whom. He said, I know whom. I know His character. I know His dependability. I know His faithfulness to His word. I know He will do what He said He will do. I know His promises. And I know whom I have believed. And I am persuaded that He will keep it until the day He comes back or takes me to glory. That's what I believe. Folks, do you know what is wrong with many of you? You know a lot about Him, but you do not know Him. You do not know Him. You've never really met Him. You've never really committed your life to Him. Oh, you've studied about Him. You believe the intellectual facts about Him. But the reason you don't have an overcoming life today is because you don't know Him. You see, because when you know someone, you know how they're going to act. You know how you can depend upon them. You know exactly what they're going to do. And Paul said, Timothy, the reason I am not afraid even though I am in a prison cell. And the reason I can sing while in chains is because I know him. Remember, 12 men went in, and only two came back with a positive report. They were different than others. They wholly followed. Why did they have that courage? Like I said, because they had a huge view of a huge Almighty God. They had a close relationship. The majority saw the enemy as giants and themselves as grasshoppers. Some of you today, you're facing things that I've never had to face. And you are seeing this look like giants. And your situation looks bleak. But you need to understand that God Almighty is the giant of all giants. And you need to lean on him, leaning on the everlasting arm. Some of you say, I know him, but there is doubt in your heart. There's fear in your heart. I really believe that. Would you bow your heads as we prepare for our invitation? I just want to ask a few more questions here. Some of you say, again, I know him, but there's doubt in your heart. There's fear in your heart. Some of you, Jesus has told more than once, you know him, but you've never followed in baptism, and you're being totally disobedient according to the Word of God, not Pastor Al. Listen, you need to come to know him in a fuller way. Paul said, I'm convinced that he is able to guard what I've entrusted to him for that day. And today, the only key to a certain future and the only victory over fear and uncertainty in life is to know Jesus Christ and to commit your life, your destiny, your future, your present, and your problems to him.
We are so glad that you joined us today. God wants to do so much for you and through you, and we want to hear about it. So please take a moment to share your story with us at mystory@lbtlima.org. If you would also like to contribute financially to the ministry, you can do so at limabaptisttemple.org or download our church app available for iPhone and Android users. Thank you again for joining us. We hope you enjoy today's message.